Move the Zoom window out of the way. That's fine. Great. All right. So UCAN, WNFS, integration, Filecoin stuff. So taking it from the very high level, because Boris was saying that part of the interest here is in finding a way to integrate DIDs more directly. So decentralized identities or identifiers, I guess, technically in the spec, takes the idea of having one or more asymmetric keys and using that to prove that you're allowed to sign some data, to be backed by a database or a blockchain, or be self-verifying, which is what UCANs are. But you could really store that collection of keys fundamentally anywhere, right? There's some advantages to not having it be more than one key, and some, well, there's trade-offs that we'll look at. One of the nice things is it's not just about a particular, or it doesn't have to be about a particular entity, but it can be like a person, be devices, a particular machine, all of that stuff, and you can create a hierarchy of identities. There's significant investment into these, obviously, in governments, and Microsoft's doing things with them, and it's kind of picking up steam. There's a whole bunch of them. The reason that this is applicable with UCANs is that it's very well suited to a capability model, which we'll spend a bunch of time talking about, which is more focused on authorization rather than authentication, right? So more about what you're allowed to do rather than who you are. UCANs take an individual public key and say, this is the root user of an account, and I'm going to delegate some access rights to other people, other machines, other devices, even if that device is being run by me. I don't want to use this public library computer with my full account balance on it. I want to really keep the scopes down. So the key itself, the root key, is your ID, and UCANs provide the authorization portion of that. There's a bunch of these I mentioned earlier. I've found a list with about 400 of them. Talking to some of the people at the Decentralized Identity Foundation, it sounds like there's well over, numbers vary, 600 or 800. So there's quite a few. They're being decentralized. Ideally, they would interoperate. That's not done yet. We're looking at interoperating with ION as a first step. The hope is that these will start to be able to work between systems, and that they'll be more self-sovereign, but they all work slightly differently, even though they have a consistent format to them. So UCANs.
And actually, just to pause on the DIDs, there's a few other things. So like there are resolvers and other things like that. So there's a hosted community resolver, where given a DID, you can go find out what you can do with it. But in practice, not a lot of people have done like end-to-end federated interop. So when we said like, hey, we've got something running, who can we plug into? Everyone was like, oh, we haven't really done that yet.
Yeah.
But that's also why we're here, because we have a running DID system and are happy for other people to use it and start using it, where the key thing ends up being that it is a portable account ID that is owned by the user rather than a magic database column, right? So that it has that ID is portable by user.
Yeah.
Any questions on that? On DIDs broadly? You were saying, Brooke, go ahead.
Okay. The other thing to note with DIDs is it's still very much an open problem how people will interact with them. Like, are they taking this magic 50 character, 60 character string and pasting that in and signing something with a browser extension? Do they have a username and password? Does it look more like OAuth? Like, nobody's really figured out what those flows look like. Are you having to pick from a drop-down list? So it's still fairly early. The underlying technology works, but the social aspects of it are still still in development, basically. So UCANs. So we've built them for our use case, which is to work directly in a browser without plugins. Browsers are a pretty scary place to run software, especially crypto. So we use non-exportable keys from the Web Crypto API, which means that we can't transfer them between systems. It literally won't let us. So we have to have some way of linking these keys together. We need to be user-controlled, user-owned, maintain as much security as possible, both privacy and secrecy, following the principle of least authority and least visibility. So we want to leak as little information about the user and have as little correlatable data as possible. Given that, you won't always have access to the root device, the one with the original key on it. So think of that as being like your original wallet, or maybe you have a wallet on your phone. Well, what if you left your phone at home, or you dropped your phone in a puddle or something like that, right? What do you do when you don't have that right on you? Has to work offline. So we can't be constantly phoning home or checking on a blockchain, anything like that. It has to be, you know, even if there's a network partition, this continues to work. We want the actual capabilities it represents to be extensible so other people can use it, plug other things into it with any degree of granularity. So they should say, I want to share everything or just some subset. And they need to be revocable. So if somebody gets into your, you know, your laptop stolen, you need to revoke those credentials. So OCAP, what most people are familiar with is access control lists, ACLs. This is a kind of reactive auth. It looks like this. So here's the user, and they want to get some stuff on this server. And they send a message. They're stopped by an auth process, which checks if they're on a list and if they have access to that data, if they're allowed to see it or modify it or whatever they're doing, send an email. And if they are, then maybe they get access to that resource. And that's how most, you know, like a Unix system works, for example, right? It's just lists of, well, who's allowed to do this? What group are you in? And every time a request comes in, we check, are you on the list, right? OCAP is the opposite. It's proactive auth. The picture is much more lightweight. So you want to check it. They say, well, I have this ticket. It says I'm allowed in. And that's the whole thing. It's self-certifying and just says, well, this is what this user is allowed to do. It's essentially a bearer token. It contains all the information about the access. In a pure OCAP system, all of the guarding has to be done upfront. So for example, you'll put a time limit on it, you put an expiry and rely on that. So you want to keep this as scoped and small as possible, because you can't, you know, we're not checking this list. Has somebody been removed from the list? It just says, well, I'm allowed into whatever, in this case, you know, like a movie for one day. I'm not allowed to go see any movie, right? Just this one. Typically, it's either a reference like a PID or a SID, some proof, or a key, so the ability to sign something. So it's proof that you're that you have reference and authority to do the thing. You typically, there's a few variants of this, but typically you're granted access on anything that you've created, so parenthood, and you can delegate a subset of access to anybody else and any other agent in the system. So this is called introduction. So you can then hand this off to other people. And there's actually really nothing about OCAP itself that's that new. X509 or Spooky and Sudsy from, you know, the late 90s have been doing this. Google has moved to a system called Macaroons. They were trying to push all of their auth through a single system that at Google scale obviously doesn't work so well. So they've delegated resources or auth from the central server to, you know, one for YouTube and one for Gmail, et cetera. And now when you log in, sometimes you'll see this in the URL bar, you'll be actually quickly redirected around to different pages, and you're collecting credentials from these other sub auth systems that at some point get even them expired, and they have to re-authenticate from the central server. So this is a you know, star shape, but coming from one central point. The originating server in that case is Google rather than the user, but it's a flexible system. It works for both. Attenuation is what we call it when we're delegating some smaller subset of rights to somebody else. So here's Alice. She has the rights to these various entities or capabilities, right? Doesn't really matter. It could be like, I'm allowed to send an email at this address, or I'm allowed to change this data in this table or log into this server. It could really be anything, right? Here's Bob, and she just wants to delegate everything that she has to Bob, and that's fine. She can just say anything, including things that happen in the future, right? Even things that aren't in this list. Bob then puts some of the stuff on his phone, but he only wants some, but not all of it, because he might lose his phone. There's some sensitive data on there. He only wants that on his work computer. And then finally, Carol gets delegated even smaller part. She's going to help him with a project. He says, okay, well, you're only allowed to have access to the dog, right? And so that's one linear chain, but Bob can sub-delegate to any number of people. So here's a different subset, and then a different set, and then later we can also recombine these so that somebody can take multiple of these certificates, mash them together, and say, hey, I've got A and B. I'm going to put this in one certificate. These are the things I'm allowed to do. I'm allowed to do these two things, for example, atomically together. So I need to show you both proofs at the same time, or I'm going to delegate some subset of both of those to somebody else. As I mentioned before, ACLs are reactive. OCAP is proactive. ACLs don't scale very well because you always have to check who has access to what. So you need to maintain some list that provides a bottleneck to performance and some central point of control. So sometimes this is acceptable, right? You can have logical centralization with consensus, but fundamentally, everybody's always having to check on every request. Is this allowed to be done? As a bonus, you can at will revoke things. Any administrator can then go in and just say, no, I don't want Boris to see this stuff anymore, and just remove all of his rights. Access control rules, because this is a checking process, grow really quickly, and you end up special casing a lot of things. And every new kind of thing in the system now needs its own kind of auth, right? And the provisioning is more complex. You can't just have somebody show up and be like, hey, I created my own thing. I would like to use your system. You have to say, well, in my system, this is your user ID, here you go. Right. OCAP works everywhere, has infinite scale, and self-certifies. Has really nice properties for interoperability, but you have to use the principle of least authority and revocation in a pure context. Pure OCAP context isn't possible, because then you'd have to check a revocation list. So typically you end up in a hybrid system where either an ACL gets bearer tokens, which then provides some sort of temporary access, or OCAP gets specifically a revocation list where it says, well, here's a tree of SIDs of UCANs that are now no longer allowed. And so that, which is what we do, we keep them right on the data, so right on the file system, and so that you're not checking some other piece of state, you're always saying, well, on the thing I'm currently working on, who's allowed to do stuff, right? OAuth versus, well, really any OCAP system, but versus a UCAN, provisioning OAuth is quite a few steps. It's been a while since I've counted these, but it's something in the teens number of steps. There's grants, tokens, refresh tokens, all of this stuff. It requires constantly reauthenticating and an authorization server separate from this resource server. So if that auth server goes down, you know, you're not able to check if it's still valid. Right? The UCAN sequence by comparison much shorter. So happens in two phases. One is the application's asking the user or whoever has more authority than it, hey, I'd like to do these things. Can I do that? And it says, yep, here you go. Here's a certificate for your DID. So if, as long as you're able to sign this, you know, you can prove that this is the capabilities that you have access to. And then sometime later it wants to use it. And it just says, hey, you know, I'm trying to use this thing as the user. And it goes, oh yeah, sure. Yep. The signature matches. That's all great. Cool. Here's your resource. And that's it. Revocation, which I mentioned a few slides ago. There's a couple of different ways of doing this because we have this chain. Oh, sorry, the other thing I didn't mention is in a UCAN, when you're doing this delegation chain, you keep the, whichever one on this diagram would be to the left and top, right? So whichever is the one that has the higher authority that is being delegated to you, you keep that in a proof to say, well, the person delegating to me was allowed to do this. And here's them pointing their subset of rights at me. And now I'm delegating this further down. As long as you're in that chain, you can revoke anyone else lower in that chain or further down in the flow. So in this case, Bob decides from his desktop computer, I don't want Carol to have access anymore. So puts the SID UCAN, the SID of the UCAN in the revocation list and says, I was in this chain. I'm revoking something further downstream that revokes Carol and everything Carol has signed. Not everything Carol has signed, but just the for that one UCAN use. This is what one looks like. So it's a JWT, we've encoded them as JWTs, mainly because they're much more familiar to people. X509 has its own format that's very 90s. So we just went with what people actually use today. So this is one with a Edwards curve. We have a time-based expiry. We're looking at ways of switching that over into something that doesn't require a wall clock. But for some actions, of course, you want to say only for the next 10 minutes, you're allowed to send an email. In other cases, you want to say, well, you're only allowed to do this many actions. And then about halfway down, ATT, that's attenuations. And I'm saying, the very top, odd and ish. So these are standard JWT keys. So odd is the audience who you're delegating to. Is issuer, who is doing the issuing and who has signed this entire token. ATT, attenuation, says in the web native file system, I'm giving you access to this path and the ability to overwrite things, also the ability to send email from this email address, right? So you can stack multiple of them together. You tend to not, but you can. And then PRF is proof, and that is the fully serialized and signed token that the issuer has that granted them at least those rights, if not more. So it shows that they're allowed to delegate this down further. And inside of that may contain another one saying the original creator delegated to them, who's now allowed to delegate to you.
One of the things that this means is that in other systems, you often have to create an API key ahead of time and pre-provision it. In this system, what it means is you could actually have something down the chain with permissions, basically access or initiate sub resources without having to create that API token ahead of time. So the very specific scenario is to give an example. So this is a photos file access. So a gallery might actually delegate access to a gallery editor, which is a separate app, right? And that's kind of the model.
Yeah. The idea really is to be self-certifying and give the user agency over the auth. So they can, the example I like to give people is you could be on an airplane, if that is a thing that we can never do again, with no Wi-Fi, build an app, create users, do all of this stuff. And that's production usage, right? Like you've built it, you're using it, it works. And then when you connect to the internet, you're like, hey, by the way, here's my user ID. So it completely flips this model from I'm getting provisioned some slice of a database that Twitter owns to I generated a random key. I'm saying that this is my my DID, my DID. This is going to be my provable identity going forward. And because these numbers are large and random, the likelihood of collision is so low, you can then use this across multiple systems as long as they know how to verify and understand that, oh, okay, this is a public key and a signature. So the picture ends up looking like this one on the left, where you have this root proof that's deeply nested. And then you have delegate one, delegate two, delegate three. And the wider out you're going to the outside of the JWT wrapper, the fewer resources you have access to. So we're always scoping it down. Right? So thinking about this in a hierarchical file system, like what we have with the web native file system, the root user has access to the entire thing. And then if I grant access to, this orange section, then they have access to everything in there. And then they can sub-delegate down to the red, but not, these sibling nodes in the black to the left. I mentioned trustless interop. So we were talking to, or have been talking to a large publishing company, have many magazines, and the problem that they have is magazine A and magazine B want to run an offer for each other. So kind of like when you'd get physical magazines, they'd have all those little leaflets saying, you get 30% off on, this other publication. What OCAP and UCANs let you do is say, okay, well, we trust the public keys of each publication to issue deals to each other without having to get the central auth server involved. And write some extra complex logic. So they're going to issue essentially a coupon that's signed and says, this user ID is allowed 30% off as a promotion. That still has to go to this external system that knows nothing about it. Right? It says, oh, is this, it goes to the second publication, which says, okay, well, I need to know, is this user ID still registered in the system? Yep, cool, right? So this is our interop with OAuth or OpenID Connect, comes back, and then we check the signatures and like, yeah, okay, cool, you get 30% off. And we have had to write no centralized complex logic for the billing system, only the second publication, this second magazine needs to know that, and they can then work totally autonomously. And so this is this breaking up of responsibility and action and interoperating with a legacy system. So some topologies for Filecoin, potential ones. So similar to what we've built today for the co-signing grant. This is, there wasn't really a good estuary emoji. So I'm using a lotus pose. So whichever one, fill it in your head. It has a database attached. And a user account. Here's Alice on her laptop, and she wants to use some amount of Filecoin and some amount of storage, right? The node can provision with a UCAN, right? Hey, you're allowed to use this much, right? And signs it with its key. She then goes to her phone and she says, well, my phone's less secure. So I'm going to only allow a certain amount over a certain period of time. And we're going to delegate that down and then sign a transaction with that. And using the key that's stored in her file system, plus this UCAN to say, well, not only have I signed the transaction with this key, but I can prove that the key wasn't stolen and signed somewhere else because there's this perfect chain of non-exportable keys that comes along with it. So we've rooted the trust in the UCAN. It comes back, the node goes, oh yeah, cool, yeah, I'll countersign that for you. We're using a BLS 2 of 2, and then sends that off to the chain. Each one of these is going to get progressively simpler.
Hey, hang on.
Okay.
So, this is Estuary in the middle. Yeah. We've replaced Estuary login with UCAN-based auth.
Yeah.
This is the end user thing, but we may also give them the capability of administering Estuary or other things like that for additional sorts of things. And in this case, we have this this key combination when we actually want to do an action on chain. So effectively, people are using a native Filecoin account in order to take these actions.
Yep.
Any other questions?
So in this case, all of the UCANs are doing is convincing the Estuary node that they're allowed to make this transaction. So it's a guarding point for their account. But the UCANs aren't used for anything on chain at this point, which would require changes to the chain, right? Okay. Anything else? Moving on. This is a self-sovereign BLS cosigner. So Alice can initiate, and sorry, I didn't animate the entire one of this one. Alice can initiate saying, hey, I already have an ID. I would like attached to my DID a 2 of 3 public key, right? Can you give me one public key that I will now do the other half for? And sorry, let me take one step back. BLS keys, you can add them together, both the keys and the signatures, and you get an end result without having to have any one party see the entire key in plain text, right? So it says, well, I'd like a 2 of 3. It says, okay, great. Here's part one, and then another server says, okay, cool, here's part two. Alice can then combine those together, create a three-part BLS, 2 of 3 scheme, and says, I would like to register this. So that's just to get the keys and move those around, where she doesn't know every piece of it. Then we say, hey, I would like to register my DID with this key and sends that over. And then that will register on chain. Here's a new user ID, right? Later, does the same thing, delegates to the phone and says, okay, well, you know, here's another fragment of my key. Here's a UCAN saying that you're allowed to use my account up to this amount, and sends that to a different node who's able to then combine those and send them along. So this is a user-originated picture of the previous slide, basically, right? And so this should continue to work. The major difference being the core key isn't held by Estuary, and there's no database required. It's only, here's some keys, and they're associated to this ID. So when I stick them together, I sign it and I send it off, and that's it.
Okay. So this particularly, so Cake, this goes to a few things around how Filecoin works, verified addresses, and a bunch of other things about whether or not we have to put things through a single Estuary wallet to offer deals, or if we can literally make user-owned deals. There's a bunch of stuff there where we're still trying to understand where the state of that is in the Filecoin network, but our general design goal has been really users should own deals as directly as possible, is how we've been thinking about it.
I am with you on that. And so we have to figure out the technical details there of what would prohibit that, given you guys have a really great resource model. And in that resource model already, there's a way to provide permissions down the chain and then say something can own something and you can revoke all of that. And that seems like a perfect way actually to tie that into a Filecoin storage deal, where then you have like an encrypted storage deal, right? So then we can have this notion of private data on Filecoin miners. And so, but how that deal gets associated back to, or that kind of thing, I think will require a lot of key magic. That's my high level, like hand wavy thought, but I don't see any other way unless we were to implement, heaven forbid, like some centralized things in between. Like S-Trade does have some centralized qualities, like very, very disappointing, but it's like part of the way to get to a thing that works. So we've made these kind of, you know, short-term thoughts. And that's why I think we're partnered and really excited about the partnerships, because we can slowly work towards this model of resource management that I think is like absolutely beautiful. So that's my two cents on.
Awesome. Which is a perfect segue into if there was a delegate aware blockchain or Filecoin in this case. So Alice is up there in the top right. She's the key creator, the account creator. Hasn't talked to the blockchain at all yet. Maybe has bought some Filecoin elsewhere, funded the account, right? Delegates to the phone. Here's some subset of storage and Filecoin, what else you need, which is able to itself sign a transaction with its key and the UCAN saying, but I was given authorization to do this on my desktop's or my laptop's behalf, right? On that node's behalf. This just goes through a dumb relay so that it can talk to the chain directly.
An RPC interface,
yeah. And just goes directly through and is handed off to the chain, which knows how to read a UCAN and follow the chain back and say, okay, this is Alice's account. Yep, the signature chain matches. Yep, this is within the amount that you're allowed to spend. Cool, done. And nothing else needs to happen. It was just a much simpler picture, but it does mean that you bake this into the protocol.
Or you make an actor.
An actor could do this, yeah.
On the protocol that does this specific thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. So something would need to run inside the, actually on chain for this to happen, the protocol or an actor or something.
Right? Consensus adjacent, shall we say.
Yes, I like that. Cool. Any questions about this? Awesome. As a bonus, I threw in payment channel interop. So here's three users.
Buy now and you'll also get free payment channel interop.
And so here's three users. They've done, locked ahead some amount that they're willing to trade back and forth along the channel. And we're just going to say, you know, from UCAN, here's a max that you're allowed to spend, right? So this is the actual UCAN itself. And then they say, well, I don't have that key, but I have this key and a UCAN that shows I'm allowed to spend stuff. So I'm going to act on the original user's behalf and send 100 fill to, I guess it's a mechanic. And then we get the receipts back and then ideally back to the original creating user. So this can end up being a really nice way of not moving keys around and not having to open multiple channels, but to say I'm allowed to spend for so-and-so. And this doesn't have to be the same user either, right? It's like I could say, well, you know, Boris and I work together. I want him to be able to spend money for lunch, you know, or something. And so I'll delegate to him the ability to pay, you know, the restaurant. Yeah, so that's the UCAN section. How are people feeling? Good? Brains full? Okay. Because
Brandon, is that a question? Please, go ahead.
The one thing I think would be worth mentioning, as you're sort of seeing a lot of these UCANs flying around Brooklyn, could you talk a little bit about, touch a little more on the composability of these UCANs and how, you mentioned at the top how in that one illustration, how they can be combined, but I think often we get this sense that these are just like a million things are all flying around, but you've got some lovely properties around the union intersection set properties of UCANs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So essentially, the section that you're talking about is this bottom right-hand corner. Is that the one? So the idea basically is, so attenuation takes large things and says, well, we're just going to scope it down to this small part here. And that's sort of the 80% use case. But there's a lot of cases where you want to do, say, an atomic action on multiple resources. So this could be two different paths in a file system that share a root, but you don't have access to the root of the two. Or different file systems, or two buckets of money, right? So there's two sources of fill. A mix of the two. They don't have to be the same kind of resource. And so by providing multiple proofs, where's the, this actually might be an older, proof here, PRF, is an array. And so you can provide multiple proofs and trace back, you're allowed to use these resources because the multiple proofs say, I can find this one in here, I can find that one in there, and all of their signatures match back. So it ends up being a tree of proofs and thus of resources. So you can take any two sets and overlap them and have a union of the two. Which can then, like in a Filecoin use case, especially with money, it's actually ends up being an interesting, purely as a thought experiment, right? An interesting way of saying, well, we want to pool our funds, but I don't want to send them around on chain, right? And spend the energy doing that. Like, just give me a credential that says I can do these things.
There's obviously existing smart contract models for this. Mm-hmm. This doesn't require that. So you could do payment channel versions or other things like this and be a little more flexible, including, of course, you don't have to have a pre-existing key that you have to join into the scheme. So that's the key thing. Ha ha.
You can think of it almost as hadn't thought about it this way before, but almost like a layer two scalability solution, like a roll up, if you kind of look at it the right way. Because a few of the things that I've mentioned have plugged into the file system and how we manage some of those resources, I thought it might be good to take you through how some of that works, again, at a high level, and just show how both we've been able to make it work in a very complex situation, but still maintain the same structure and have it leverage parts of that. So, web native file system has a single root because it sits on IPFS, has a public, private, and shared sections. So public is a little bit of extra structure on top of plain IPFS, UnixFS. Private uses a bunch of extra encryption to hide data, and then the shared sections are encrypted, but done with asymmetric key exchange so that I could, for example, share keys and a pointer with Boris so that he could read something in my private file system. So these are the virtual nodes. As I said, they have a little bit more structure. So a raw node, as we call it, is what we get directly out of GoIPFS or JSIPFS, we use both. We add two layers. So one that has metadata on it, and then raw file data. And if it's a directory, it may have child nodes. as well, which is this the green one off to the side. But fundamentally, they have essentially the same structure, right? Just one of them has more children, and those children have a semantic meaning in the system. And we let users create arbitrary metadata, put, you know, information about, you know, commit messages or MIME type or sources or where they got the data from, anything like that in there. So it's a flexible open schema. Hard and soft links, obviously, we're probably pretty familiar with those. If you're referencing something across multiple file systems, then you're going to need some kind of a top level pointer and then a reference, you know, a path down inside of that, right? No surprise there. Hard link is just using content IDs. We've also made it persistent and confluent. So nothing's ever deleted. We've actually turned the garbage collection completely off. And so any updates happen by appending new nodes, and that provides new routes. And then we provide pointers back into the old structure with a lot of structural sharing, which IPFS ends up being really nice for.
So specifically, we've turned off garbage collection in the nodes that we run because we have this file system where we keep the file system root that has all of the blocks in it. And then of course there's additional blocks that, but they're all additive, including of course things like soft deletes, where in lots of operating systems, we have concepts like trash and other stuff like that. We may in the future need to run some like compaction or something, essentially garbage collection. But because of the IPFS block dedupe stuff, in practice, this should be very efficient.
Yeah. So UCANs end up being a really nice fit for any kind of side effectful process, right? So if we're doing decryption of an encrypted node, we can do that directly with a key, right? We don't need a certificate for that. But if we want to go in and actually say, hey, I don't like that I accidentally published some content, you know, and I need that actually removed, we have a special capability for the web native file system that says, yeah, you're allowed to actually go back and overwrite history and change things. By default, they're given append-only access, which is this appending system, but they can then be granted these higher levels. And then there's one more, that super user, that says that they can do really whatever they want. They can administrate the account, right? On our service, right? Which is mainly managing the DNS link, primarily. So yeah, that's just the structural sharing. Rearranged, you know, this is just to show that we can pull it up and have the one root, even though the previous root was this photos at R0, directly below it. Private nodes, we have this encryption plus an AES-256 key that we may be adding more key types soon. And then that decrypts and we rediscover some structure for this node. It's a crypt tree, so that node contains all of the keys for its children. So having this top level AES key means you have all of the children AES keys and all of their children's, et cetera. So it becomes this recursive system. So in the same way that the UCAN has this way of saying, well, I'm going to scope down, same thing with read access. We're able to say, well, we're going to scope down just the read access to some subset of the tree. Right. So we can rediscover this structure. We actually, I think it might be the very next slide. Yeah. So we can decrypt it, obviously. We have this subtree access. So if I give the key for the red section, you can't read what's in orange. If you have orange, you can read red, right? So again, it's this exact same scoping mechanics. We also use a ratchet, so a spiral ratchet, which I saw got mentioned in Slack earlier. Which lets us do quick fast forwards. So every node gets even in time, because we have this persistent structure, right, gets its own key, and that key is derived from the previous key. We've set it up to look more like this, so that when you're going from, and this is just a hashing algorithm, right? So normally when you're hashing a hash, a hash of a hash of a hash of a hash, you follow this single 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5. You can think of it as versioning like that, right? But if we have some millions of updates and you want to jump ahead much faster, we're providing the ability to essentially jump across lanes from 1 to 4 to 15 to 34 like that. The numbers are actually much larger. You can jump ahead, what was it again? It's like some thousands at a time. I can't remember the exact number off the top of my head. It might be 64,000 at a time. And that lets you jump much, much further than having to do, you know, millions of hashes. This gives you essentially like a light cone saying, okay, well, you entered being able to read at this point and at this depth. So you're allowed to read from here on. Yes, this is the slide that I was looking for. Even though the paths in on the public side saying, well, you're allowed to write to this path is just says, well, here's the path, here's the segments on it. The private side, we scramble it. So we've broken it up. Everything gets what looks like a completely random identifier and is placed in a prefix tree, which is still append only. And if you're given a key, then you can rediscover the structure. We're using, it's called a Nyberg accumulator, but it's essentially just a Bloom filter, and a Bloom filter of the key and all of its parents' keys, and then some obfuscation in addition. And as long as your UCAN contains an element that's inside or and its parent chain, also all of its elements that are in that node, then you have access to write that path without even knowing what the path is. So we can do this in a, it's not fully zero knowledge, but it's pretty close. It's a very low knowledge way of providing pathing without having some kind of a central process managing what you're allowed to have access to. And doing the multi-tenancy. So we can do direct multi-tenancy with a UCAN. So this is how we generate those filters. We take a hash of the AES key, append to it the ratchet, stick those in a Bloom filter, right? And all of its parents' keys. So you don't know all of the parents' keys, you just have its filter as well. And you're sticking that in as well, right? We call that a bare filter because it gives you a little bit of information about how deep inside the tree you are, right? We then saturate it by hashing it into itself. So we take this bare filter, we hash that, that gives us a new element to place in. We hash that, new element, place in. And we do that until we have a threshold of number of bits flipped. And then we use that as its name in the tree. But that maintains all of the previous elements in the Bloom filter, right? So, which gives us the zero knowledge pattern, or the close to zero knowledge. And just because people ask about it, if you're trying to now append to the structure that you don't have access to the entire thing, we let you root as much of it as you can. And anybody who comes along that has higher access will then collaboratively root into this structure and place things inside. So you say, well, I'm allowed this piece, I'm allowed to write below it, but I don't have the root itself. Okay, I'm gonna attach this here, here's my backlink, and place that inside the prefix tree. And the next person who comes along is gonna say, well, I need to look further down into the tree, try to fast forward based on this ratchet, and then I will attach it because I have further higher access. So that looks more like this. So somebody else, we've now done multiple revisions off of that one. Somebody has a higher level of access. They say, oh, okay, cool. I can now attach your changes to my changes. And I can attach that higher up in the tree until we get back to the root eventually. But anybody who has root read access can always find, can walk down and then fast forward the versioning using the spiral ratchets, and then walk down and fast forward and walk down. And then also probably worth noting that this is a Merkle CRDT because of its, which was work done at Protocol Labs. Thank you. Because it's persistent and immutable, every leaf ends up forming, this is what we call the shadow of it. So where one here would be the latest version. So this is number of revisions back. It's a CRDT because we can apply them in any order and we'll get a consistent view of the data. So we make progress through branching because this is happening totally concurrently and asynchronously in a merge model, but it's still consistent with all of the read and write access on each branch. And whoever's doing the merging needs to have write access to that merge, and they're going to make progress on that portion of the tree. We share UCANs and read keys directly in the file system by doing key exchange with your DID, right? We presume that you have these keys. You have exchange keys, which are RSA, because that's just the most common ones. And we can use them in the browser and not in the browser. We keep them the public keys in a well-known location on the file system and then share across all of those. Here's certificates for your DID. And here's some read keys. And then you can come to it asynchronously and say, oh, cool, here's my stuff. So it works a little bit like a gossip system. So that gives you a pointer and a key inside. And then you copy it into your own system because you don't want to lose it. Yeah, those are my slides. Thanks. I realize that that's a lot to cover. this is still a high level. There's a lot of detail, especially in the file system that I'm moving quickly through. Those are the parts that are related to auth. I would love to take any questions if people have them or any thoughts in general.
So again, Kate, that's a lot. What we talked about with Y, which he'll have to look at this video afterwards, is when Y and I were on the call, he was like, okay, so if we want to use these DIDs, we'll need to like wrap them in some sort of token. And I'm like, good news, we have that part already, right? And UCANs are basically fancy JWTs. So we're essentially unblocked on that side of things. The other two parts end up being, that is useful to know, all of our stuff is in TypeScript right now. We have a Haskell implementation on our own server. And Brendan, who's on this call, has done a implementation of UCAN in Go and is working on an implementation, a very early public file-only implementation of WNFS as well. And so we're happy to have people like adopt it, implement it in other things, do interop, and then, of course, other work that we do. So if we end up integrating with Microsoft Ion, we will have some of the first DID interop. So that what that brings us is someone might have a Microsoft DID and be able to log in to Estuary with that or any other system and be able to control Filecoin resources all the way back to their Microsoft Ion DIT. And that's the part that we can start seeing really powerful and being part of that goal at the end of the day. Another specific example, I'll basically wrap up after saying this, is that, you know, Brendan is the founder of Qwery, Q-R-I. So it's essentially sort of like a GitHub for giant data sets. So being able to work with multi-gigabyte or larger files where someone comes in and edits a single cell of some kind, You can imagine a permissions model in there, but you can also imagine a model where, hey, I want to take some of that and I want to take some of that data and I want to publish or visualize it at a regular web URL. So that might be an interesting way of integration between Fission's publishing platform and Query, where instead of having to build an entire publishing platform, they could just be like, oh, here you go. Here's a domain name that you can publish query stuff at. So that's some of the stuff back and forth that you can do within the system.
Yeah, and touching really quickly on, sorry, Brandon, I'll just quickly, a system like Query. So we built UCANs to be extensible, right? Like from day one. And so you should be able to, prefix, in our case, WNFS, and then define whatever semantics you want. And they're just ignored by everybody who doesn't consume them, right? And so it doesn't have to come back to us or some central registry. It's just whoever knows how to receive that message can receive that message.
Yeah, and I was just going to add, perfect tee up, Brooke, thank you. Because Query is using it for, so we wrote a Go implementation of UCAN specifically because we have an issue where users need to collaborate on data sets, where I need to be able to give somebody permission to edit a data set, and UCAN sort of a very nice model for that. And it was really nice to sort of read through the Fission stuff and realize that, quite frankly, we didn't need to talk to them about anything about on the UCAN frontier. We just needed to choose capabilities, a namespacing kind of prefix for capabilities. That's part of the reason I named the company a short name. It fits really nice into really small web tokeny type things. And so we'll do exactly that when we're actually doing collaboration. And I think it takes a little while to get your head around the object capability model, but once you get there, you start to realize like it is the practical inversion that we're looking for with Web3 of like, I get to do whatever I say that I get to do, and I hang out with who I want to hang out with. And it's just like that expressed as a technology. And it works really well for our purposes because we can sort of say, it gives somebody, it's a lot easier to capture, you can imagine in data set sort of maintenance and access control. If you want to get down to like this person can only edit these 15 rows, it's actually much easier to express that in an object capability model than it is in some system where we would try to sort of in advance determine what type of access people would want. It takes a little bit to like unlearn the ACL stuff, but yeah, it's good stuff.
Yeah, I think it'll take me a little bit of time to unlearn the existing world. I love the presentation, especially around the resources and like basically the comparison between ACL and this proactive model. I think it's just beautiful and elegant. And also can see it making sense with Filecoin because, you know, if I have a file system and I have associations of like deal IDs to all of the files in my file system, I know exactly where they are in the world. That level of capability doesn't exist in the cloud today, right? Because like usually if you use object storage from any of the providers, you're just throwing it up and then you're like, okay, I'll just get a location back and then I'll get something back with this. You have something that's kind of like a world first almost. It's like I know exactly which computer box in a network is hosting my file. I know it for all my files. And so that part actually makes a lot of sense to me. The whole like storage part of that and having the receipts, what's super challenging for me as a designer, like trying to understand how to like productize this for people to use is like, okay, well, the other side of this of like how I like, you know, is all of the function that we have actually, you know, like, is it going to support a better experience around using this stuff? Or is it just like more of like, you know, of a peace of mind around like, I know exactly how my stuff exists on the internet. And so I'm grappling with some of that in my mind. I'm also grappling with kind of like, you know, how like retrieving from the network works and like seeding a new file system that's yours and those kind of things and technical details around there, as well as like performance, you know, around encryption, decryption stuff. I'm not super familiar. So these are kind of things that I'm learning about as we go. But I think I left this with a much better understanding of how the file system itself with its own resources works really, I think it's meant to be that it works really well with Filecoin, and it's supposed to have like a symbiotic relationship almost, where it's like, now not only is the file system like you have one on your computer, and like, let's say we blow your computer up and it's gone, you know, like whatever, you know, now there's actually like a cold storage for all the resources on your machine. And now you have a network of clients that you run, maybe like 20 devices that all have the same auth to these resources. And that's really, really cool. So slowly wrapping my head around this, I think.
Yeah. So, I mean, you mentioned a few things in there, so I won't try to go through the whole list. More than happy to answer questions. I mean, both here, if there was any of those that were like really burning questions, and also afterwards in Slack or Discord. On the last one that you mentioned, one of the nice things about moving to this model with both encryption and OCAP is you could have any number of providers or any number of nodes, and they all speak the same language, and they don't have to synchronize what is the access like. They just see, oh, you have a key, you're allowed to decrypt that, cool. Or, oh, you have a certificate and it says you're allowed to do these things, great.
Yeah, I think the other piece just ends up being, you know, I think the mental model for users and accounts is sort of like, I don't care about any of that stuff. Can I access my stuff? So, you know, we have a few things in some of the like specifics of the implementation that we've done, but the nice thing about the UCAN thing, you know, there are constraints about some of the like security model pieces, but you can choose different pieces. Like, we are going to put a database in here because it's going to do X, Y, and Z, right? Or we're going to add a cosigner so to make sure that we're, it's still non-custodial, as an example. Like, you can mix and match these things to optimize for different stuff. I think the other thing is that you don't need a separate system for server to server or CLI or anything. And which is probably important. Like, so that Patrick guy had a question about whatever scary shit he was trying to do between servers and keys and permissions cake. And I'm like, you need to make sure that connection is secure. And you can't hand wave over, oh yeah, we'll just keep some private keys over here. It's like no.
Yeah, right. Like in our use case, which is not the Escher use case, right? Again, we're using non-exportable keys in the browser. And that might be the originating key. And we're linking, so like somebody's in the browser, they set up an account, creates a key pair, and they create a UCAN and send that to a Go IPFS-backed CLI tool, which does store a key on disk. That's, you know, because it's on disk, it's more available, but the root of that key is in, or that ID lives in a browser, right? And so there's been no server in here whatsoever. So it just really lowers the amount of times, number of network requests, the number of times you have to do things, increases trust because it's all cryptographically signed all the way back down, right?
But ultimately, we're gonna have to get the flows right, explain what's happening, right? Like, I think that's the tricky balance of this stuff. You know, we're ultimately not yet, you know, Brooke gave an example of doing things that, some things of like, hey, if you want this stuff to be anchored in Filecoin and reach out to the rest of the web, I would say that's the other problem that we solve. Is, and what we've done with the web native Filecoin thing is we said, okay, can we put private keys in the browser, private blockchain keys in the browser without a browser extension to open up a wider solution space? I think that was another piece with Brendan. He's like, okay, I've got these keys over here, but oh shit, if I want to build it into a web app, I'm going to need, basically something like a UCAN to be able to pull that off. Right. And I think that's our other part, is that we want to move past. Browser extensions are the equivalent of keeping a private key on disk, essentially, right? But it really constrains the number of users. But even there, you know, I've had an early discussion with Dan Finley from MetaMask, where MetaMask might become a cosigner. And that could do certain flows as well. But again, you're keeping this non-custodial where the full key itself is much harder to hack. And of course, you could do multi-sig scenarios with this as well in different ways.
It's actually what we're doing with Sarah and I from Resource, which is a on-chain credit protocol. I have to jump, but thank you guys so much. That was awesome. Is there someone we can reach out to? Is there an email we can reach out to explore further?
I am the sacrificial email front end for the company, boris@fission.codes.
Perfect. All right. We'll send you an email. Thank you so much, guys.
See ya.
So we should feel free to use. So what I have in S3 right now that Brian and James worked on, which is like, thank you so much for doing that. I know it wasn't the ideal situation, but you know, I think what we should view S3 as is like the, even though it is a web app and it has like some centralized components, we should view it as a playground, right? We should view it as a playground for finding the sweet spot for how do we get this right. And I don't even know of a Chrome extension. I personally, like, so many times have I been tempted, like, oh, I'll just do Magic Link and like whatever. And I was like, no, that doesn't feel right. So I think like we should figure out how we can get this thing into either like I think a lot of things that are out of the box, like we can even redeploy onto, you know, like the Fission, right? Into like make it like a deployable thing into your own Fission account. That might be even better than doing what we're doing right now. Then you wouldn't really need to have like an auth at all. That would probably be the best re-architecture for this thing. And then since it's just deal-making code, any client that's running the thing can just run the thing. The problem is that what we do with our shuttle system right now is a centralized like boost for large scale data storage. So we do some things that you could not just run in your browser or run in like, you know, like a server box. You need to expend like $3,000-$4,000 a month on a server box that can handle that kind of throughput. So that's like the challenge, right? Because I would love if everything we did, we just ripped off user accounts, we made it into a simple web app. You deploy that web app in your Fission thing, like just like James Longster's app, right? The financial app, right? You just do it that way. And that way you don't even need this notion of like, oh, I'm part of that. And I read that, I was like, damn it, like I wanna do that, right? But there are elements of what we do, like running up a shuttle in the UK so that Magic can transfer 8 terabytes and like breakneck speed, that we, you know, we mask with this like a whole bunch of front-end servers and accounts so that you can just get this ease of experience. And I think crossing that bridge is the bridge we need to cross. Maybe like we do like a S3 Lite that is a deployable version into the Fission ecosystem that doesn't have user accounts and maybe can do the stuff from the client, and we explore that option, and then we gradually bridge the gap in the middle. But I think it's like open playground, so we'll just play with options. And yeah,
I think Estuary is the like you are doing the hard work of figuring out how to make deals repeatable and are like facing a lot of the pain, so the rest of you everybody else can just be like, here, put my stuff on Filecoin.
Yep.
And I think that's really valuable. And just thinking about which pieces of that might become more remote API like is the thing, right? Like deploying your own front end, like doable, but probably there's only a handful of people to do that. On the other hand, okay, here's how you turn it into an SDK, and here's how you get capabilities from Estuary to, you know, like reflect that you have that data cap or whatever that else might be, could be some of the flows.
Right. And we'll re-architect that together. I think we'll figure out those details.
Yeah. We're at the get it working.
Mm-hmm.
And now we know what some of the tools are we have to work at, and whether we need to improve the transactions API or where we need to go back and look at core Filecoin accounts and messages. You know, that's going to be like a 6-month process if we go down that route, right?
Your suggestion, I want to make it very clear about like every user getting their own Filecoin address. That time when you made a suggestion, I thought was like really, really good. Instead of like doing what we're doing right now, which is like, we're going to send a transaction from one address to another and then look at the messages and then like do some account book on ourselves, which is like very inelegant and then makes me embarrassed to even say it. But like, that's like, you know, I think I can't wait to get to those more optimal solutions once we have the critical path kind of like established and we can rip out. So yeah.
Awesome. Anything else? I'm gonna say thank you to Brooke again and hit the stop recording button for starters.